In Python, we gain access to the library with import numpy as np. The as np is a convention, and you could actually stop at import numpy, although we usually do it as np. The fundamental object in numpy is a numpy array. We create them with np.array brackets and then square brackets and pass them a list. So we will pass this the list of 1, 2, 3, and then that will create the numpy array of 1, 2, 3. This is the output. We can assign a variable name to an array. So we will call this one a, with a is equal to the numpy array, and then outputting a should give the same result. NumPy arrays have an important attribute called a shape. If we were to write a.shape, that returns the shape of a, which in this case is 3. That is because it has 3 values in it. A has 1, 2, and 3, so its shape is 3. If instead a had 4 values, so maybe 1, 1, 2, 3, we would see now that a's shape changes to 4, because there's 4 things in it. At this point, you might be wondering why we need a NumPy array, since Python lists can do both of these different things. We can put elements in them, and we can ask how long they are. We need them because of multi-dimensional data. The easiest example of multi-dimensional data is a table. For example, you could have one row of data, say the first row is 1, 2, 3, and then the second row is say 4, 5, 6. In order to make a NumPy array out of this, we will make this into a list of lists. We just need to enclose this whole thing in brackets and then place a comma here so that this outputs as the list of the list of 1, 2, 3 and the list of 4, 5, 6. Generally, for readability, we also add a space here so that all of the brackets line up nicely. Of course, if these numbers were to be longer, like 52, the right side would not line up, but at least the left side still would. Now we're ready to turn this into a NumPy array. We could simply copy this piece of information and write np.array, circular bracket, and then paste that information. If we fix the formatting, we close that to see the array of 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. Like before, we can attach a variable to this, b, set b equal to that array, again fix our formatting. You can always just back up and then press enter and it'll line it up properly for you. If we output b, we should see the same information. Like we did with a, we want to know what the shape is of b, b.shape, and it will output the tuple of 2, 3. Breaking this down, it's because first we have two things. We have this thing, and then we have this thing. And this is a 3, because in each of these two things, in that and in that, we have 3 items. 1, 2, 3 in the first, and 4, 5, 6 in the second. We would say that B is two-dimensional, because there is 2 components in its shape, specifically 2 rows and 3 columns. NumPy arrays are technically called n-dimensional arrays because you can have an infinite number of these dimensions. It allowed for you to have one dimension in A, it allowed for two dimensions in B, and you could have 3, 4, 5, 6, or an infinite number of dimensions. Something that we cannot do with a NumPy array is have an inconsistent number of elements. For example, if we remove this 2, we'd have the first row has 2 elements, just 1 and 3, and the second row has 3 elements, 4, 5, and 6. Well, it's not going to like that, and it says you're creating something that it calls a ragged sequence, because it has an inconsistent number of elements in the dimensions. If this has 2, well then this has to have 2, and if this has 3, well then this has to have 3. So far we've only used integers, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6 for example. We don't have to do that. We can also use floating point numbers, as well as true and false values, or booleans. So we will copy this and replace this with a variable called c. And we will make this simply 1.1 and then 5.5, so that this has now everything's a decimal. What would happen if we replaced one of these numbers with a true here? This actually makes it a decimal, because the true would convert to a 1, and the 1 would convert to a 1.0 to make it a decimal. If I instead made one of these a string, so this will be the string of 6 instead, all of them will convert to strings. It has to be consistent. This is mostly being done for tutorial purposes. Most of the time, we'll have arrays of all decimals, all integers, or all Boolean values. You can technically have more complex data types, but most of the time that's a bad idea. So I'm just going to delete this array, and we'll go back to just B. Now currently, B's shape is 2x3, but that's not the only possible shape for B. It could also be maybe 3x2, for example. If we were to do B.reshape, and then pass that shape, say 3x2, well then now it's the same information, but with 3 rows and 2 columns instead. That's also not the only possible shape for B. It could also just be 6, and then nothing after it at all. It could be one-dimensional. All of those shapes worked because they assumed that B has 6 elements. If we instead pass the shape of, say, 5, well that doesn't make any sense. You cannot reshape an array of size 6 into shape 5. The shape has to imply that it has the same number of elements that B does. It doesn't really matter what its original shape was, it had 6 things. You can't shape that into 5 things, and so we're going to leave it as this one. Now I'd like to go through some quick ways to build up NumPy arrays, because as we've been writing it so far, actually making the Python list and passing that to np.array is very slow. And if we had arrays of, say, a million numbers, that would take a very, very long time. Two numbers that we very commonly want an array of are zeros and ones. Luckily, we can do this in NumPy with np.zeros and then pass a shape, say 2x3, and that will get a NumPy array where everything is a zero in the shape of 2, 3. If we instead wanted to get ones instead of zeros, we'd simply copy this and replace the zeros with the word ones. And now this is a NumPy array of shape 2x3 where everything is a 1. If you look closely, you'll see that everything here is actually a decimal or a floating point number. If we instead wanted integers, we can always specify the data type of an array with passing the argument dtype and setting that equal to a type itself. I'll just pass it int, and what that will do is make all of these zeros integers. Analogous to Python's range function, there is also an np.arrange function, which will take a starting value, we'll choose 1, a stop value, we'll choose 10, and we can call that to get the array of 1 through 9. Note, just like Python's range function, that it actually goes up until the stopping value minus 1. If we added in a third value here, we'll do 2, that means it goes up by 2s, so it's going to start at 1, go up by 2 until it hits 10 minus 1, which is 9. That's exactly what we see here with 1, then 3, then 5, then 7, then 9. The last function I'm going to show for generating NumPy arrays is my favorite, which is called np.linspace. This still takes a start, we'll choose 1 again. It takes an end, we'll choose 11 again. But instead of specifying the step here, we are going to specify something called num, and set that equal to, for our example, it'll be 11. So what that does is it determines itself what the step is needed to evenly space 11 numbers between 1 and 11. Note that it actually does include the end value here because this works well with floating point values and not just integers. This is really just for integers. To slightly change it up, if I made this a 12 instead, you'll see the step it needs is actually 1.1 every time, so it says you need 11 numbers between 1 and 12 evenly spaced, so I'll say 1.1, 1.1, 1.1, give you all of those numbers. Now I'm going to go back to looking at the array B, which is the array of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 with a shape of 2x3. Sometimes in NumPy arrays, you want to access individual items, so maybe you want to ask what is in the first row, what is in the second row, what is in the first column, what is in the last column, what is in the second row, the second item. There's so many things you might want to access, and we do this through something called indexing. It's easiest to get used to this with some practice. So if we were to do b(0), you might be able to guess that this is the first row of information. Note that it returns it as a NumPy array, and so it's really the NumPy array of just the first row. 1, 2, 3, it has a shape of 3. The way this indexing works is very similar to Python's list syntax. If we were to do b(1), well that would be the second row. But if we try to do b sub 2, well, that doesn't exist. That is out of bounds because the size is 2. We have two different rows, but you tried to get the third one, which doesn't exist. Just like Python indexing, the colon operator means you want everything. So if we just specify this, well, that says give me all of the rows, which is really just the same array back. This allows us to get a particular column like 1, 4, 2, 5, or 3, 6 back with colon, and then we place a comma and give an index corresponding to the column. This is column 0, this is column 1, this is column 2, so if we specify column 0, that gets us back 1, 4. If we instead wanted a particular item, then we just specify both the row and the column, so if we do 0, 0, that corresponds to the very first element, and we can see that it is 1, just the number 1, and not the NumPy array of 1. Now the reason that NumPy is so popular is because it does math very, very quickly. If you instead wanted b, but to have all of its elements times 2, so this would be 2, this would be 4, this would be 6, and so on, well, we can write that with just b times 2. This was an example of something very important called parallelization. Parallelization means that operations were independent of each other. So this 1, we needed to multiply it by 2 to get 2. We could have put that on one computer, but then on a different computer, put 2 times 2 and got 4, and somewhere else did 3 times 2 to get 6, and 2 times 4 to get 8, and so on. These are parallel or independent operations, and you want to do it whenever you possibly can, because it's so much faster that way. If we were to instead write the same code that this does, but in a different way, where one by one we go through each element and we change it to whatever it was multiplied by 2, it is so much slower both to write and for the computer to calculate. So to show you what not to do, you could actually overwrite b with 4i in the range of 2, because there's 2 rows, and then for j in the range of 3, because there's 3 columns, and then set each element b sub I sub j equal to whatever it was before, so we'll grab that and set it equal to that times 2. This will work, and if we output b, it does actually overwrite b itself and set it equal to itself times 2. But it's way longer to write, and it's way slower for the computer to run. By the way, these two are very similar, except they're actually slightly different because the first one only made a copy, and the second one actually rewrote b. Arithmetic is not the only thing that NumPy can parallelize. We can also do comparison, like b is greater than 7, and that asks every individual element if it is greater than 7. And if it is not, like 2, 4, and 6 are, it'll place a false there, and it'll place a true with anything where it is true, like 8, 10, and 12. This is very useful because we can actually index NumPy arrays with these questions. So if we did b, and then we did the index syntax with square brackets, then paste in b greater than 7, well, that returns specifically the NumPy array of 8, 10, and 12, because those are the ones where that question was true. An important and potentially confusing idea in NumPy is the idea of an axis or multiple axes. It really involves a direction, and I'll just show you through an example. One way it comes up is through the np.mean function, which is for taking averages. If we call np.mean on b, well, that takes the average of the whole array, which is 2 plus 4 is 6, 12, 20, 30, 42. Divide that by 6, we do get 7. But what if instead we wanted the average for each row? So this average would be 4, and this average would be 10. Well, we can do that by specifying that the axis is equal to 1, and so we get the array of 4 and 10, which is the average of each row. If instead we wanted the average of each column, well, we'd switch the axis to be 0, and so we get the average is 5, average is 7, and the average is 9 instead. There's one axis for every single dimension, and so if we tried to do axis equals 2 here, that is out of bounds for dimension 2. We don't have an axis for that, and so this fails. But similar to general Python stuff, if you do minus one here, that would assume the axis is the last one, and so this goes back to the average of each row. There's also similar functions like calculating the standard deviation, and this would do the same thing but with that function instead. Somewhere else it comes up is if you want to stack NumPy arrays and join them together. We would do this through the numpy.concatenate function, and so we join them together by saying b and b times 2, those are the two that will join together, and we want to specify an axis. By default, it's actually axis equals 0, and what happens here is we stack them. So this is b, and this is b times 2. So the concatenation of them is b, and then b times 2, vertically. But we also could stack them a different way. If we specify that axis equals 1, well, that specifies that this is going to be b, and this is going to be b times 2. I'd now like to finish off this tutorial by showing you how NumPy arrays often arise in practice. One way is through the fromTensorFlow.keras.datasets library, and we can import MNIST, for example. MNIST is a particular dataset on handwritten digits, and we can turn that into NumPy arrays. We'll call them xTrain, so xTrain is 1, yTrain is another one. We write it like brackets like this just because of how this function requires it. xTrain, yTrain, and xTest and yTest. These things are 4 arrays if we do equals mnist.loadData. You can see that it had to load this data, but afterwards we should see that each of these things are NumPy arrays, which means they should have this shape attribute. So if we ask what the shape is, we can see it's 60,000 by 28 by 28. We haven't dealt with three-dimensional arrays yet, but often they come up when they are pictures. So here we have 60,000 28 by 28 pictures. A second reason they come up is through the pandas library. If we do import pandas as pd, and then we load a data frame with df is equal to pd.readcsv, and then we pass a file name, we're going to pass the sample data slash California housing train.csv name, and we get that as a data frame, and it should output just like this, which tells us we have 17,000 rows and 9 columns of longitude, latitude, and other data on housing. The details really don't matter here, but this should look a lot to you like a NumPy array, and we can get that as a NumPy array with simply df.toNumPy, and that converts it to its array form. We can, of course, ask this shape because it's a NumPy array and it has 17,000 rows and 9 columns, just like the data frame does. I'm going to finish this off with a quick homework assignment, and if you don't want to do it, that's fine, but I would recommend doing it because it is helpful. So get array A. I don't care what it is, any array. And then what I want you to do is save that to file. So save A into a file. You'll have to look up how to do that, I didn't teach you. The last thing is load it back. So load A back into memory from the file. If you want to drop a like and subscribe to the channel, I'd greatly appreciate that. And I hope you enjoyed the video. I'll see you next time, guys.